So right now I'd like to talk to you about the integrating factor method, and it's a particularly fragile method, though general, for solving first order linear or ordinary differential equations. So let's start. With the following first order linear ODE. So it's very important to note that this equation has to be linear for this trick to work. I do call it a trick because it brings this first order linear ODE into formal correspondence with the product rule. And so it's really only applicable right here. And the reason why I call it fragile is that it nests integrals together. And so you have to expect that odds are, given some functions which will leave as placeholders here, you're not going to be able to perform the successive iterations of integrals that this form allows for. So the ODE is dy dt plus p of t times y is equal to f of t, and we'll call that equation 1. The whole idea is that we are going to multiply this equation through by an unknown factor mu of t, which we will call the integrating factor, and so multiplying through by this mu of t leads to an equation of the form written here. And so now the whole idea is that we can notice the emergence of a product rule-like structure by saying, here I'm leaving y alone, and here I'm taking the derivative with respect to time of y. So now if all of this stuff right here, which I'll color code in red, is such that it obeys in words, leave y alone, take the derivative of this stuff. Take the derivative of y and leave that stuff all alone. Then, what I can say, or what I want to say, is that I would like to say that this is equal to the derivative with respect to time of mu times y. And then, if that's the case, then the product rule will tell us, well, this is, take the derivative of y and leave mu alone. So I'm going to write the derivative of y with respect to time and leave mu alone. And then I'm going to add to that, now leave y alone and take the derivative of mu. So y is being left alone here, and here I take the derivative of mu. Now, the hope, well, the first thing that we can see is that these two terms right here are identical. These are already equal. Check. Now, the hope is that I would like to make these two terms equal. I'll put a question mark there. If I can set the blue terms equal to each other, well, they're already equal to each other. Well, the question is then, if I can set these green terms equal to each other, then the terms on the left-hand side of equation 1, this term in blue and this term in green, would be equal to the terms on the left-hand side of this second equation, which is the equation that comes from the product rule. And so if that's the case, the implication is that the left-hand side of this equation is equal to the left-hand side of this equation, so the right-hand side of this equation should be equal to the right-hand side of this equation. So if I can pull this off, the implication is that the derivative with respect to time of mu times y is equal to mu times f, which is a pure time equation. Okay. in a pure time equation is an equation where the right-hand side, so the dependent variable here is y, the right-hand side doesn't have any y, so all that appears on the right-hand side is just the time variable hidden inside this mu and this f, and so if I anti-differentiate the left with respect to time, so if I take the antiderivative with respect to time of the derivative with respect to time of stuff, I'll just get this stuff. So I will get mu of t times y, and that should be equal to the antiderivative of mu of t times f of t with respect to time. So now, the question is, what is mu? In answer to that question, well, I look to the green stuff. The green stuff tells me that, okay, mu times p times y is equal to the derivative of mu with respect to t times y. If I formally set these two equations equal to one another, and y is not zero, then y will cancel out on both sides, leaving me with an equation for mu. So the green equation, if set formally, or the green box, if the two terms are set formally equal to one another, I get d mu dt is equal to mu of t times p of t. And this is separable. Not only is it separable, it's asking me here, I'll just erase this t here, and that would be, find me a function where if I take the derivative with respect to time, I get p of t. Right? So the implication is that, well, think about it this way. If p of t were constant, this would ask the question, find me a function where if I take a derivative with respect to time, I just get p times that function back. Well, we know that to be the exponential function. So let me just write mu of t is equal to e to the p, right? And if there were a t right here, if I take the derivative of mu with respect to time, then a p comes out front, p being constant, and that would give me a p times what I started with, so p times mu. Well, what I have here is a p of t, so the question is, find me a function where if I take a derivative, I get the same function back, times some function, p of t. Right. Well, e is going to be the function which gives me the same function back. So e will be such that take a derivative with respect to time, I'll get the same function back. Now I just have to figure out what to put in the exponent so that I get a p of t. Well, if I were to put a p of t in the exponent, then I take a derivative with respect to time, I'd get this e back, but I wouldn't get a p up front, I'd get a p prime. So what I want here is the integral of p with respect to time. So now, if I take a derivative of mu with respect to time, I will get the derivative with respect to time of the integral of p of t dt times e to the integral of p of t dt. But the derivative with respect to time of the integral of p of t with respect to t, would just be p of t, and e to the integral of p of t dt. But this is just nothing more than my mu. Okay. So, what do I learn from this? I learned that to solve equation 1, I can multiply the whole equation through by an integrating factor, and then, based on this set of equations here in green, I can choose that integrating factor such that this equation, which is equation 1 multiplied through by the purple mu, is formally equivalent to this product rule, which is the derivative of the product of mu times y. So, that leads to a pure time equation. But the question is, what's this mu that's floating around in this equation? These integrals, I might be able to do those things, right? But I need to know what mu is first. Well, solving the green equation by setting these terms formally equal to one another leads to a separable equation which can be solved for mu. And so that is the first key outcome. And that is that I have a viable equation that I can use to get mu of t. Mu of t is equal to e to the integral of p of t dt, where this is where I find p. Whatever's multiplying this y term when written in your linear equation in equation 1 form here. And then after that, after I get mu, here is equation 2, which is my pure time equation, which I will then work on solving. So, and then I'm going to introduce here step 0. To solve a linear equation through the integrating factor method, I write my linear equation in the form of equation 1. This is what we'll call standard form for the linear equation. Once I do that, I've figured out what p of t is. Once I know p of t, I put p of t in this exponent under this integral sign, and I perform the integration. You should note that by performing the integration, you're going to find infinitely many integrating constants, or integrating factors. This is what mu is, the integrating factor. Well, you only need one of those, so set that constant of integration equal to 0. Once you have that, you have an integrating factor mu. Once you have the integrating factor mu, you know what this mu is. In the problem, you should know what f of t is, so you put f of t right here. And then taking the antiderivative with respect to time of both sides leads to a mu, which you know from part 1, times y. So the derivative structure has been taken off y, and that's equal to the integral of mu, which you know from part 1, and f, which you know from the equation, the linear equation, and then you perform this integral. Once you perform this integral, it's through division, you'll solve for y, and then once you've solved for y, you've solved the ODE. This is where the nested integrals come up. This is an integral on mu times f, but inside of mu is another integral. So you have to believe that odds are, unless S and P's have been chosen just right, it is going to be pretty difficult to perform integrals inside of integrals, these iterated integrals. That's all.